Now, when most people think about research that involves more complex design, you know, like multivariate research or factorial research, what they're generally thinking about is experimental kind of studies, you know, studies that look at how various kinds of like drugs interact, for example. But you could also do these kinds of complex designs with correlational kind of research. So what I'm saying is factorial designs can also include only non-manipulated independent variables, like quasi-independent variables, for example, or correlational study. And just in general, you should always be cautious about inferring causality from correlation. This is something we talk about all the time when it comes to scientific research because of those problems I mentioned in a previous video. You know, the directionality problem and the third variable problem. You just always need to be mindful that because two variables are related, that doesn't mean they have a cause-effect kind of relationship. Now, what this means when it comes to a more complex kind of correlational design, this means that if you find a main effect or if you find an interaction, that is an interesting, you know, relationship you found, but it doesn't mean that these main effects are actually affecting anything. It's not that kind of cause effect. So it's, I guess, bad terminology that we have for this, but that's just the terms that we use. So even though we call them main effects, they're not necessarily, you know, kind of cause effect relationship. But let me just give you an example of how this kind of stuff works. So imagine that you're a researcher measuring mood. Like, you're interested in how people with a positive mood or a negative mood and how that can affect their self-esteem and willingness to have unprotected sexual intercourse, for example. So you want to look at one factor, which is their mood, and another factor, which is their self-esteem, and see if these things have a, you know, a role when it comes to willingness to have unprotected sex. This is the kind of research people have actually done. A lot of research has been done on stuff like this. So in this case, you could use a 2x2 factorial design, you know, positive negative mood or high or low self-esteem. And if you do this kind of research design, then you'll have the potential to find a main effect for mood, a potential to find a main effect for self-esteem, and a potential to find an interaction between the two. But keep in mind that we didn't manipulate anything here. We're not manipulating the participants' moods. We're not manipulating their self-esteem. Therefore, we cannot say that these things are causing the person to want to have unprotected sex. All we can say is that these things seem to be related. These things can predict, you know, their future behavior, perhaps. But they're certainly not the causes of those behaviors. They might be, but until you do actual experimental research, you cannot know for sure if these things are causal factors. Now, if you want to try to assess the relationships among multiple variables, what you're going to be doing is pretty complicated. Most complex correlational research does involve measuring several variables and then trying to assess statistical relationships between each pair of them. So this is a lot of statistical analysis going on. Thankfully, we do have modern, you know, modern programs and techniques to be able to do this stuff efficiently. And this assessment that these computers do often takes the form of a matrix of correlation coefficients, similar to this one you see right here. So you see we have four different variables: need for cognition, intelligence, social desirability, and dogmatism. And you can see how these things are correlated with each other. Now, right here, where we have need for cognition and need for cognition, you can see that one is just a line because there is no such thing as a correlation between itself. No, we can't really correlate a variable with itself. So that just means nothing. Just ignore that. But we can look at the correlation between intelligence and need for cognition, and you can see that got a positive 0.39. That's not terribly strong, but it might be significant. Then here we have correlation between social desirability and need for cognition, and social desirability and intelligence, and so on. And if you notice, all these numbers up here, that's just like the mirror image of these ones down here. Because if you take a look at it, need for cognition and intelligence, and then need for cognition and intelligence, it's just duplicated data. This is just the standard way that we show these kinds of correlation coefficients. Obviously, there's a lot of duplicated data and just meaningless data, like that when we try to correlate a variable with itself, that doesn't mean anything. So I understand if these kinds of charts can be a little confusing. They're not perhaps as best as they could be. That's just the way we do it. So complex correlations are interesting, and that can provide a whole lot of data. But another complex statistical analysis that we often do is called factor analysis. And if you think back to what the word factor means, you already probably have a sense for what this is about. What we're doing in factor analysis is we're trying to figure out what factors might be in the data. We're trying to find the variables. So it's kind of like we're approaching the problem from the other direction. Instead of setting up the variables and then looking for an effect, we're studying the effects and then trying to find the variables. So factor analysis is this complex statistical technique for studying relationships among a large number of conceptually similar variables. And then we organize those variables into small numbers of clusters. And the way we decide which one goes where is based on how strongly correlated they are with each other. So in this little example you see down here, we've measured all these different variables and we've seen that some of them tend to be more related to each other than others. And based upon these relationships, we can start to get a sense that maybe there's at least four different things going on in this data. There's four separate things that we seem to be measuring in this data. Exactly what those constructs are is not necessarily always very clear, but there does seem to be at least four like separate constructs that we're measuring in this case. And those underlying constructs are what we call the factors. You're probably very familiar with the Big Five. The Big Five is the most popular model of personality in psychology today. If you're going to do any research in personality, you're probably going to be doing research using the Big Five personality traits. And this factor analysis is exactly how we found these five traits. What we did is we looked at a large number of words. We looked at, you know, all kinds of text for all the different words that describe personality, and we did a factor analysis comparison on those words, and it came out to these five. So these five factors, these five personality traits, just seem to be highly correlated with each other. For example, when it came to the personality trait of extroversion, we found a lot of words such as warmth, gregarious, activity level, positive emotions. All of those things seemed to group together, and we just put the label on that group of extroversion. And then when it comes to the personality trait conscientiousness, that was built from the concepts like dependability and self-discipline and need for achievement and future planning. So I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail about all the different traits out there, but you can see how this would work. We just take all these different terms that mean all these different things and try to connect them in various ways. And based upon the connections we build, we start to notice that there seems to be five separate concepts here that we're looking at. So factor analysis is a great way to figure out what's hiding under all this data, what's driving all the data, you know, what the causal, you know, relationships might be. Now, while correlational research cannot unambiguously establish that one variable causes another, it can be used to rule out plausible interpretations. In other words, if you find that two variables are not related, then there cannot be a causal link between them, In order for there to be a causal link, they have to have a relationship, some kind of relationship. And the primary way we do this is through statistical control of potential third variables. What I mean by that is this is a kind of control where a variable is included in statistical analysis to try to measure its relationship to the variables in question. And if we find that the third variable doesn't seem to have much of a relationship between these two other variables, then we can rule it out. So that's the basic idea of doing like a factor analysis. We can learn a lot about which variables are related, and we can learn a lot about which variables aren't related. But one final thing I wanted to say when it comes to these more like complex kinds of statistical analyses is something called a multiple regression. So multiple regression is a statistical procedure for studying multivariate relationships. The basic idea of a multiple regression is that we have these multiple predictor values that we're using simultaneously to predict the value of a single, what we call, criterion variable. Another use we have for multiple regression is to try to learn more about a relationship between two variables. What we do is we just add other variables one at a time so that you can identify and use that kind of statistical control I was just describing to potentially eliminate those confounding variables. So the end result of doing a multiple regression is that you'll get an equation, kind of like this one you see down here, which expresses the dependent variable as this kind of additive combination of independent variables. So at the end of the day, what this all really means is that you're building a bigger picture. You're getting a much bigger perspective on what the data looks like and how these variables are related. You know, it's a lot easier to do research when you just have a few variables and you're looking for simple relationships, but by including more variables and finding how these complex relationships work can give us a much more accurate picture as to what's actually, you know, happening in the real world.